my fan's unplugged. There we go. It's hot up here, okay? It's already warm up here, and I turned the AC up to that side to 70. And who's warm out there? It's getting more and more hands. Will, take your suit jacket off, brother. Stay a minute. We are going to be in Psalms 119. Imagine that, Psalms 119. And this is our fourth week in here. Who, just wondering, has taken time to read through all of Psalm 119 since we've started this? Oh, so it's a surprise to you each week. No, we're going to read, just going through it one week at a time, each stanza. It's the Hebrew alphabet. And just enjoying this so far. We are going to be right in here. And I hope you have your Bibles. I really do hope you have a copy of the Word of God with you today. And you're really pulled out. Oh, not the phones. But we are going to be starting right in verse 25 today. Psalms 119, verse 25. And let's start reading this. I'm going to read it. I just want you to follow along. My soul cleaveth unto the dust. Quicken thou me according to thy word. I have declared my ways, and thou heardest me. Teach me thy statutes. Make me to understand the way of thy precepts. So shall I talk of thy wondrous works. My soul melteth for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according to thy word. Remove from me the way of lying, and grant me thy law graciously. I have chosen the way of truth. Thy judgments have I laid before me. I have stuck unto thy testimonies, O Lord, put me not to shame. I will run the way of thy commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart. Let's pray here. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would be with us today as we study your word, as we continue to look into scripture. Father, we ask you with the young people, Lord, even though we spent a week evangelizing and sharing the gospel with them, there is still some that have yet to come to the knowledge of Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. And if today is the day, may they come to know Christ as their personal Savior. Please, Lord, let that be the event. And let us never stop to pray for souls. Let us never stop to pray that we would grow in grace and knowledge of you. Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with the service for the next half hour, that we'd be focused on your word. Father, that we would continue to grow, that we would love you more, and that we'd understand more about your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I wrote a shorter message. My average message is about 9 to 13 pages, somewhere between there. This week, it was only 7. I thought with us singing so many songs, it would take us longer. You play fast. It's okay. No one minds getting out early, especially this side of the room. You guys are looking a little pinkish already. It's not warm, but we are in this. And I want us to always start with the Hebrew letter here, Daleth, or you can say it Dalet. But that is the symbol. And if you were to ever look up Hebrew, if you were to try to see what does Psalms 119 look like in original Hebrew, just so you know, you do not read starting at the left over. You actually start at the right reading backwards. So if you're like, I don't see that symbol in Hebrew, in case you're feeling really nerdy and you want to look it up, you're going to be reading it backwards probably. And that little symbol right there is what it is. And it's really interesting because I encourage you to look up these letters on your own, to keep doing research of the symbolism of God in Jesus Christ through all these letters. Because this one represents a door. And it is a door or a gate that indicates a resistance and a state of selfishness and humility needed to pass through. It indicates how to pass through the gates to know one's own mystery and being returned to the power of God. It tells us one of the pictures of this also represents that in order for us to have the saving grace or to go through our strength and struggles is also a picture of the doorpost. And you can see if you look at it, like, wait a second, kind of looks like a little bit of a doorpost. It's half of it. And the blood has to be applied. That's where we get our strength from. But don't forget, each one of these letters represents a different meaning, which is why there's 22 stanzas in Psalm 119. And the big idea today that I want us to get across is this. Even when we are down and discouraged, God's word will provide. Even when we are down and discouraged, God's word will provide. I don't want to sound, some people say it sounds very negative to say either you're always going to be going through something. Either you just get into a storm, in the middle of a storm, or about ready to go into one. I get it. It sounds dark and discouraging. You say that's just life. But here's the thing. There are going to be down days in this life. If you've made it without a single down day, you're amazing. But that is not the norm. You're going to have days where you are down. You're going to have days where you're discouraged. You're going to have a lot of days where you're discouraged. And discouragement is part of life. And the down and discouragement also should drive us to our Heavenly Father, to the one who makes a difference. And we're going to see that God's word will provide. One of the things you always need to look at what is happening in Scripture in Psalms 119 when it is being written, they don't even have the New Testament. Think of how blessed you are that we can call in the name of Jesus Christ now. That it's already happened, Emmanuel, God with us. He came and in the form of a baby and lived his life and died on the cross. And he says, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the earth. And I will never leave thee. No man can pluck you out of my Father's hand. I will pray that the Comforter will come soon unto you. And we have the Holy Spirit. At this time when this is written, all they had was the law. Some of them, depending on how you want to look at it, didn't even have the major prophets yet. So what are the major prophets? Isaiah, Daniel, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel. And then the minor prophets were non-existing. All they had, they're just looking at what God has done, and they said God's word will provide. And I want us to look at this and understand that there is discouragement in life. And the first thing I want us to, my soul cleaveth unto the dust, quicken thou me according to thy word. The beautiful imagery here, you say it's beautiful, it's dark, it does seem dramatic, and you've had these moments. I feel like I'm dying. I feel like nothing's going right. I feel so discouraged. I feel so heartbroken. I can't believe this person did it. Why does this happen? What is going on? I just feel like I'm dead on the inside. Feels like nothing can be right. And one of the things I want us to look at this as you think about this is start being honest with God. I don't know who you're fooling besides yourself when we try to hide like everything's all right. And God's over there saying, it's okay just to say your soul cleaveth into the dust. You feel like you're dying on the inside. Feels like nothing's going right. It's okay because I already know what's going on with you. I'm right here beside you. I already know what so-and-so said or so-and-so didn't do or so-and-so did do. I already know about your family history and what's been going on for generations. And I already know about your future family. You don't even know what's going to come into place because I'm there as well. And I'm aware of everything. So the psalmist here who writes this stanza, this poem under Daleth, is just being honest about his position in this moment where he is saying, my soul cleaveth unto the dust. And if there's one thing that you can get from today's message, it would start being honest to God about where you're at. Because I don't know why, but we want to lie about everything. How you doing today? I'm good. Be like, are you though? I'm good. It's all good. Thumbs up. That's what Easton, your grandson, used to do. We used to talk to him. He'd say, how you doing, buddy? And he'd give you a big thumbs up. And it was just this little tiny stick of a finger, but little guys, I love little guys. My 3 and 4 year old boys, they're always so exciting because they give you a big thumbs up. How you doing, buddy? And if they don't want to talk, either they're a talker or they give you a thumbs up sometimes. And it's funny, but as adults, God's over there, hey, how you doing? I'm okay, God. God's like, how you doing? how you really doing? Because you know I heard that conversation on the phone where you were complaining about everything going on in your life on your ride home from work. I was there. How about we be honest right here? You see, God is omniscient and knows everything and is already fully aware of a situation you're having. So today, why not choose to be honest with God? Why not choose to be honest with God? And I want you to think about this. My soul cleaveth unto dust. And today I wrote this whole line blank because everyone focuses on it right away. Today I'm struggling with blank. What is it that you're struggling with that you need to be honest with God and give it over to Him? And then we're going to look at God's word and how it'll answer. I don't need, you say, I'm not going to show you. Don't show me your answers, okay? This is for you and God. This is a moment for you right now. No invitation needed. Be honest. Be honest. I'm struggling. I'm discouraged. I am angry. I have bitterness. I have unforgiveness. I have sorrow. I have hurt. I have depression. I have frustrations. I have sickness. I have health. I have family relationships. My soul cleaveth to the dust. I walk around like I'm smiling, but on the inside, I am a wreck. You say, well, that's the introduction to it, because it's an introduction that we need a door open to us to get to God so that we can have the help that we need. Daleth. And you see that God's word will provide, and then as soon as you do that, it's this word quicken that we don't use anymore. Quicken. The only time I've ever heard this word, the quick, is when I was cutting my dog's nails and someone says, you cut the quick. And you say, what's the quick? That's where you cut the nails too far on your dog. Those of you ever trimmed your own dog's nails because you can't afford to pay the groomer to do it because you're on a budget. And you clip your dog's nails and it accidentally bleeds, because quickeneth means the blood, means the life. And it's saying quicken, and we're asking God to give you life according to His word. His word, not our word. Because His word is life. His word will bring life. Quicken is asking Him to bring us to His life. Quicken thou me. Bring me to life according to your word, because I'm at or near a death-like mindset. There's a song that we used to sing, and I don't know if we sing it today. No, we did not sing it today. I'm drawing a blank already. Tell it to Jesus. Tell it to Jesus. He is a friend that... Anyone know the rest of it? That cares, that listens, that loves, that will be there. And it goes through. And here is going through the next verse. You got to look at how it plays in. I have declared my ways, and thou heardest me. Teach me thy statutes. God, I was honest about my position. I was honest about what's going on. I have declared it, and you heard me. Therefore, teach me. I want to summarize it like this. When you pray and cry out to God, expect to be heard and expect to learn. I should have changed the font to black. I'm sorry about that. But it's okay. Expect to be heard and expect to learn. You know that James will go on to say, you have not because you ask not. And often when you say, I don't feel like God's hearing me, one of the things I want to say is, are you even praying? Not are you whining, not are you crying, but are you praying? Because when we pray, He hears. This last week, I was with some individuals and got a little interesting conversation, and we talked about prayer. And I said, my God hears my prayers regardless of what tongue or language or anything else like that I speak. And the moment I pray, the Bible says that the Holy Spirit makes groanings and moanings, which we understandeth not, under the throne of grace. Not only does that happen at the moment of prayer, but also Jesus Christ stands before the throne of grace. Therefore, we can boldly come to it and enter into His presence. And Christ represents me. And God hears our petition of prayers. But it's crying out to God, and when you cry out, expect to be heard. Do you know why your kids will yell mom and dad? Because they expect you to answer. Do you know who they're not yelling for, mom and dad? They're not yelling, Mr. Beast, help me. Those of you with parents know exactly who that is, or if you're your kids know who Preston is. They're not yelling for the YouTubers. They're not yelling for Mickey Mouse. They're not yelling for some imaginary Disney character. They're not yelling for someone they see on TV. They're yelling and calling for help for people they know will listen. And when we pray, you should expect to be heard and expect to learn. This is where we mess out a lot. It says, to teach me thy statutes, is we want to cry out, but then we don't receive the blessing of the relationship, and we don't understand the quickening because we don't expect to learn or listen when we pray. Prayer is communication between us and God and us. And the Bible says that when we pray, that the Comforter will guard and keep your heart. You say, where do you get all this from? From the Word of God. And that's why we keep emphasizing, read the Bible. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, in prayer and supplication, make your requests be known to God, and the God of peace will guard and comfort and keep your heart. Philippians chapter 4. You realize that God wants to teach you things, but you need to be willing to be taught too. Being willing to be taught is a hard thing because, one, you have to be willing to listen and you have to be ready to learn. So the question I started thinking about is, how do you get ready to learn or to be taught? I know for some of you, it's been a few decades since you've been in school. I looked back there and she smiled. I can't look over there now. Some of you, it's been 60 years, 65, almost 70 years since you've sat in a classroom. And you say, man, it's been a long time since I sat in school. But it's interesting, when you sit in school, your teacher would want a few things. They would ask you to take time to sit, to be still, to not have anything on your desk besides maybe a pen and a piece of paper. Sorry, some of you, it's just a... Sharon, was it a chalkboard or did you actually have paper? I had to get her, okay? I haven't seen her for a couple weeks. Joke's on me. There was a stick in the dirt. But the funny thing is, if you were to ever read how Abraham Lincoln taught himself to read, it was actually a coal shovel in his cabin, and they would write the letters in the shovel and learn your history. You would go and you say, I get my piece of paper and my pencil out, and I'm going to sit here, and I'm going to be ready. I'm going to wear an outfit that I feel comfortable enough in to sit. Wait, isn't that important? You ever wear something that didn't quite fit right and you had to sit in there and all of a sudden you're like, I have to go to the lecture like this? And there's a reason why when I look for conferences to go to, I used to go to Bible conferences and everyone wears suits and ties the entire week. And I'm sitting there like, I don't feel comfortable wearing a suit and tie after maybe 3.5 to 4 hours. Like, it's hot, it's sticky, I lose things in my pockets. It's just like you're wearing capes everywhere. And I started thinking, like, you know, people aren't learning as much as you think they are in here because they're uncomfortable after a while, but you wear a comfortable outfit. You want to get a good sleep. You want to eat properly so you're not hungry, because if you've ever sat here in the middle of service, and there's a reason, you ever sat and been really hungry after church? So hungry that you had a hard time focusing on what's happening. You're like, already. You know that eating a good meal helps you learn and listen, as well as putting yourself in the right mindset. And those are all the things we do academically to learn from ourselves. But if you look in class, if you go back to thinking about in school, you would take time to review the notes from your lesson. You would take time to listen to the teacher. You would take time to read your textbook. You would write notes down of things that stood out to you that you felt like would be important when it came time for the test or life. Remember the days of school, though, that we often had distractions. We'd have someone who would talk in class, someone who never brought a pen or paper, someone who never read the textbook, someone who never did the projects, someone that never did anything. And yet we wonder, why doesn't it feel like we're learning things when we come to church? I have to wonder sometimes, when you study and sit down to read your Bible, when you get down to your quiet time, when you actually take time to come together, are you even coming with a heart ready to learn? Are you coming for the crowd, the acceptance, the acknowledgement? You see, if there is a classroom, I tell this to young people, and I'm hard-nosed, but I will get on young people. If Chad here was the teacher, and I had a kid sitting like this, looking over here at Glenda, I would snap at that kid and said, you will turn, and you will face, and you will have your shoulders, your hip, and your shoes pointed towards that person to listen to them as they're talking. And you say, why? Because you are 60 to 80% more likely to retain information when you are looking, when you are facing, and your posture is towards that person. Singled you out today, right? Like, I'm stop coming. No, that's an important thing because it matters. But when our mind and our heart and our body is facing towards the Lord to learn and listen, you're going to be taught something. So what does that look like? Well, for one, where is that dumb thing? I have it somewhere around here. Oh, it's over there. That phone, all right, flip it away. Good luck having that moment of prayer with the phone in your back pocket. Good luck having your devotions on your phone every single day and trying to get something out of it. You say, but I do. Ooh, keep praising the Lord. Tell me, if you've got Facebook, Instagram, social media of any type on there, as well as trying to do your Bible reading plan, you're going to find yourself distracted at time. Praise the Lord, we figured out how to turn off email notifications because we get about 75 of those a day. We don't even know what they're for. Just get emails. And all these different things, and you wonder, I want to learn and be taught something, but I also have to speak to Him and be willing to be taught and in a place to be taught. Are you teachable anymore? Are you teachable? One of the hardest people to teach in any career is somebody who used to do this job years ago. Back in my day, well, forget about back in the day, it's the way we're doing it today. What we used to, I don't care about how you used to, it's what we're doing today. It's very important that we look to things. And as we do this, we hear that He says, make me to understand the way of thy precepts. Precepts is another way for word or law, God's Bible, basically. And as you learn, it says, so shall I talk of thy wondrous works. Be taught to understand and understand that you might share. If you are a believer of Jesus Christ and you accepted Him as your Savior and you have followed Him and you have, maybe you haven't done this yet, maybe you need to, you in believer's baptism, you have the responsibility to share the gospel. We actually talked about it called the Great Commission, Matthew 28, verses 18, 19, and 20, or 19 and 20, if you want to single it down even more. It's referred to as a Great Commission. It's very important that we understand this because as you understand, as you come to knowledge, you are to share. You are to share information. The purpose of education is not to sit back and look intelligent, but so that you can live it, and as you live, you share with others. Again, I was teasing Jerry, and I said, I got my Hobbit or my Tolkien reference in there again. Where you at, Nathaniel? He disappeared on me. He always appreciates it. And I couldn't help but think of my dear Mr. Bilbo Baggins. Bilbo Baggins, those of you who don't know, you'll be educated for the thousandth time, is a hobbit who likes to stay in his hole at the end of Bag End. And he likes it because he has his cakes, he has his bread, he has his tea, he has his garden, he has his pipe. All right, he's a hobbit, who cares? And he goes forward with things, and Gandalf finally talks to him and says, life is more than your books and maps. Adventure, real life is out there in the world. There's this drive in today's society that we gather a lot of information, and don't forget, knowledge puffeth up, and that we can sit back and not share it with anybody or live it out properly. We just have all the information. And we have all this thing, but the purpose of this is, so I shall talk of thy wondrous works. Why would God want to bless you with an abundance of knowledge and information if you're just going to sit on it like a dragon with all your knowledge? You are to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Again, we see right afterwards here that my soul melteth for heaviness. Strengthen thou me according to the word. Remove from me the way of lying and grant me the law. Grant me thy law graciously. The request is to be removed from lies and be in the word of God. There's a whole prayer right there. Have you prayed to be removed from those who would lie to you in your life? Have you prayed to be removed from lies in your life? Be careful, because the moment you do, you may find out your TV breaks on you today. You might find the cable news channels stop working. You might find that half a TBN no longer works. You might find out that there's a lot of lying happening in your life. A lot of infomercials, a lot of different things. And this verse right here, it says, my soul melteth for heaviness, strengthen me according to thy word. We see the sorrow, we see the heaviness. It says, remove from me the way of lying. This is also you speaking lies and lies being around you. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. It is humorous. I always enjoy the humor of men versus women. And the question was, hey, does this dress make me look, I don't know the word, full? And they'd be like, oh, darling, no, it's just, you know, you're just coming to figure. And the faithful wounds of a friend is, hey, you might want to start considering salads. You know, we don't hold our punches. We'll just look right at you and just say, man, I didn't know they were having a sale on marshmallows because you look puffy, you know, like just going right at it. And you say, what kind of friends do you have? This is the relationship a lot of men have with each other. We are brutally honest in a humorous way with one another. How many of you have ever experienced friendship like that before? Okay. And how many of you wish you've had honest friends in your life like that before? You're like, I don't know if I'd enjoy that, but it's a bit harsh. And it's comical, yes. But do you know, you also need someone to look at you when they're speaking absolutely terribly. And they say, what do you think? And you say, it's not what I think, but I'm going to tell you what the Word of God says. The Bible says that we ought to forgive one another. Be tenderhearted, even as God for Christ hath forgiven us according to Christ. The Bible says that a soft answer turns away anger. But grievous words stir up wrath. So what are you saying? I'm saying, honey, that you were wrong for saying just one more thing in your argument, and you should have let it go. I'm saying, sir, that when that fight happened in your marriage, you probably should have said, time out. I think we're both worked up. Right now, we might just need a few minutes to calm down. Psychology says it should take 8 to 10 minutes for us to socially, to emotionally have a reset in this argument. So let's come back to this conversation 10 minutes from now and see where we're at after we've cooled down. Because they say it's either you're going to fight, flight, or freeze. And some of you love that humor, and I'm a flightless bird, and so you're going to fight. But you calm down. You see, we lie to ourselves thinking constantly, and we need to ask God to remove us from lies and be in the Word of God, because God's Word is the same yesterday, today, and forever. God's Word will always be with us. For right here, we're going to wrap this up. I'm going to finish right on time with what I call the I statements. If you want to look at this passage, you might be able to see it started in verse 30 to the end. There is multiple statements where he says, I. The author of this passage is saying, I. And the first thing he says, I have chosen the way of truth. Thy judgments have I laid before thee. I have stuck unto thy testimonies. O Lord, put me not to shame. I will run the way of thy commandments when thou shalt enlarge my heart. First one, I have chosen the way of truth. The opposite of being removed from lies is to be what? In the truth. Now, we could take the creative liberty and Jesus and say, Jesus is the way, the truth, and life. Absolutely, so be in Jesus. I'll tell you what, you want to be in Jesus, you're never going to go wrong. Be in truth. Be in God. He is a constant. He is consistent. There is no lie to him. Remember, Satan is called the father of lies. the first thing he does in the garden as he creeps in is he looks at the woman and he asks a lying question. Yea, hath God truly said that if you eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will die? Lies, deception, and God is truth. And you see the first one is truth. If you don't want to be around lies, the opposite is I want to be in the truth. But don't forget, it's truth with grace. Some of you use truth and you weaponize it. Be like, well, I just want to speak truth. Be like, that was malicious. That was angry. Okay, there's a loving relationship where we like to, that we sometimes have, and there's no one asked you for you to speak truth in that conversation. Well, I just couldn't hold my peace. I think you need to go back to the Word of God where it says, hold thy peace. Or maybe go read Proverbs again where it talks to, I have my son read Proverbs, write a verse out almost every single day because we're having some attitude adjustments. So he reads the Proverbs and he writes down one key verse a day. And I'm waiting for him to write down that verse where it talks about it's better to hold a knife to your throat than speak in the presence of others at times. Because it's like, buddy, there's sometimes you just need to be quiet and not say anything. Hold the tongue, buddy, because he loves to speak. Those of you with teenagers and tweenagers and anything else like that with children, they'll speak with their eyes. They'll speak with their hands. They'll speak with their body. They'll speak with their head. They even speak with their hair, okay? They bob that hair. And then they'll speak with their mouth. And you're like, woo! I have chosen the way of truth. It is a declaration and a speech that you are saying, I choose truth. If you don't want to be around lies, you need to choose truth. Do you truly want truth, or do you desire to live in deception of the comfort and conformity of this society? Because choosing truth will always make you uncomfortable. Choosing truth will make you feel awkward. Choosing truth is looking in the mirror at times and seeing what's actually going on. Choosing truth is going to the doctor and actually getting their report and listening to the facts. Choosing truth is acknowledging that relationships aren't always right and they need to be corrected. Right after that, it says, I have laid before me God's judgments. My heart is towards you. Even when I don't understand the logic, even when I don't understand other things, I desire your ways. This is such a relationship, because in any marriage or any relationship, there's going to be times you don't understand one another, but because your heart is towards your spouse, you say, I don't understand what's happening, but because this is what's going on, I support you and encourage you. And even when I don't understand God's judgments, I will put them before me. Even when I don't understand what your law says, even though I don't understand what is happening, I will do this. It's a lot like following an epoxy steps. If you've ever done epoxy or two-step epoxy of any type or glue, sometimes it doesn't make sense. You'll be sitting here thinking, well, I don't understand how this works. I'm just supposed to pour these two components out, mix them on a little plate, and then apply them, and it's going to break some sort of compound. It's going to be harder than cement. That doesn't sound right. And you don't trust the process, but you have to say, you know what, though? I am going to believe that this is going to work out in the end. And when you follow the steps, all of a sudden you're like, hey, it worked. Who's done that before with the home repair project? The first time I did electrical, I did that. I was like, I don't know what I'm doing, but this said to put this nut on this one and screw this into this. And then at the end of the day, I flip the breaker back on, and they're all supposed to work with no sparks. And guess what? It worked. And if you're a union electrician in here, I never said any of that. But we see that your heart is towards it. The next declaration is, I have stuck, or I cling to thy testimonies. There's a song that we sing, the Old Rugged Cross. And in the Old Rugged Cross, one of the verses, so I'll cling to the old, how many of you guys know that? To the old rugged, I'll cling to it for what it stands for, represents, because I want to it. You know what it is we don't cling or stick with God's commandments as soon as things come to us. As soon as the hardships come, as soon as there's a little bump in the road, we will abandon it quickly. We just don't trust God's principles. I have stuck to thy testimonies. Earlier we saw the writer speak of a heavy soul, but now that we see through Scripture that no matter what, he will cling to God over the darkness that has bothered him, and he will stay with him regardless of the situation. It is not easy to go through life together with people. And God says, it's your choice to make a statement of, I will stick with you. Even when I don't understand it, even when I'm confused, even when my soul cleaveth into the dust, even when I'm heavy-hearted, even when I'm sorrowful, even when there is joy, I will cling to you. And then right here we see, because of the clinging in the Scripture, it says, put me not to shame. And then verse 32, I will run the way of thy commandments. Running is unique, because in the Hebrew culture, to see an elder or the patriarch of the family to get up and run is radical. Absolutely radical. And some of you have told me, Pastor, if you see me running, you better run because something's chasing. I don't run after anything. I don't know if I could run out of this building. If you yell fire, just open the door. I'll get there. If I don't, I don't. If I do, I do. Either way, I'm in the Lord's hands now. Okay? I get it. But it's the intent of the heart and how you pursue after God. I will run and seek after God's ways always. This is why on Sunday nights we're talking more and more about our God, and we're going through names of God. We looked at God Almighty, God Most High, looking at different things, because the more we understand how our God loves us and cares for us and provides for us, the more we realize that we actually have a personal relationship with God. How much He loves us, how much He cares for us, how much He desires for us to be with Him in fellowship and relationship. It's actually absolutely baffling to me that you can talk to believers who said they've gone a full week without praying to Him, reading His Word, listening to spiritual songs, or talking anything about God for the entire week. How could you do that? Because you say, well, you've never done that? I have, and I felt distant and far away, and I missed things. And then coming back felt kind of awkward at first. It was like being a stranger all over again. I absolutely, I love my wife. There we go. You say that nice and easy. The first time my wife went away, it was the weirdest thing. Family passed away, so she had to fly back to Michigan for a funeral. And it was during just a weird time. She was gone for 5 days straight. Newlywed couple, okay? How dare a couple who's been married less than a year spend a whole week away from each other? That was a few years ago for some of you. You're like, yeah, that sounds desperate. Long time. And when she came back, it was a sweet embrace. We're so happy to be around each other because we love and we seek after one another. It's weird. We don't even like camp sometimes. That 5-6 days away, we're like, that felt like forever. And those of you that have been in a relationship for a long time, some of you are like, I am grateful to see him go. I don't know how Charlene used to do it, saying goodbye to her hubby. Good luck in the submarine, and watching him go off to sea again and again, that longing. But do you know, how do you seek after God? How do you run after Him? Where is your heart towards Him? Do you pursue Him? Do you love Him? Do you care to have a relationship with Him? But as you do that, the following statement is that He'll enlarge your heart. And you see this, enlarge my heart, is referring that the love that you have for God grows. And as it grows, you continue to run towards Him. You ever notice how couples enjoy spending more time together as they get older? You should. You build more and more things together, life together. You enjoy things. You appreciate things. The projects you've accomplished in your home because you had to put in the sink yourself because we're regular people. You can't afford to have that done professionally. You had to install cabinets and floors and do all these projects. And every time the kid ran through a wall, you say, how does that happen? It just happens. They push through a wall. They fall through a wall. They accidentally close the door too hard. And you fixed it. And there's memories and joy in the house and in life. And you grow in a relationship. And your heart gets bigger and bigger for the person you love. If you knew a man who just left our community recently, Mr. Pretty, you would understand how his heart enlarged towards his wife. Every time you went and visited Mr. Pretty, he had a beautiful picture of his wife. With his permission, I can say that because he told me it was beautiful every single time. And he would say, isn't she beautiful? She had the bluest eyes, and she always wore her hair short and had a beautiful smile. And he'd say some other things, and he was just in love with her. And even though they're no longer able to hold hands on this earth, it's weird to say this, but he loves her more today than he did a year ago. Because God and his heart has enlarged towards her. And we were talking 2 weeks ago before he left. And I said, Mr. Pretty, it might seem like a long time here on earth, but it's just a blink in the second of God's life that you're just going to be holding and walking in the presence of our Lord, and you and Fran are going to be together before you know it. And he cried and he said, I know. But until then, it just feels like a long time. Our hearts grow in love, and you should pray that your heart grows towards God. And that as you do that, you run after his commandments. If you have your Bibles open still, you can see the key words here. How we're referring to God's word. In verse 25, it says, according to thy word. Verse 26, it says, thy statutes. Verse 27, wondrous works, thy precepts. Verse 28, unto thy word. Verse 29, thy law. Verse 30, thy judgments. Verse 31, thy testimonies. Verse 32, thy commandments. Do you think that God, who preserved his word and gave us a copy of it, wants us to study his word? The answer better be yes. Because we see that through the hardship that he was going through, that God's word will provide. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for you today. Father, we desperately need to be people of the book. We need to be people who read your word, who live by your word, who pursue after your word, who desire your word. And Father, we ask that we commit ourselves to not just reading it, but living it. Heavenly Father, may you correct our hearts as we have hardened ourselves against you. Father, may we be honest about the positions and the sins and the issues and the things that we try to hide or we hold back from you. Father, you are aware of every single one of them. You are God Most High. You are Lord of Lords, King of Kings. You're omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. And Father, forgive us for even trying to hide things from you because you are aware of them. And Lord, as our soul cleaveth into the dust, may we find peace in you. Lord, if there's one in here that is still hiding, keeping it hidden to themselves, saying, I have not accepted Christ as my personal Savior. I haven't done it. I've never personally asked for forgiveness. If that's you today, would you allow me to pray with you? Would you just raise your hand and say, I've never personally asked Jesus Christ to forgive me. I don't know what it means to be saved. I've never done that. That's you. Would you just raise your hand? I just want to pray. Lift your name up in prayer. If you're in here today and you're saying, man, I see it over and over again. For 32 verses, I've seen the Bible reference God's word over and over. But yet, for some reason I'm struggling getting in the Word of God. I'm struggling understanding. I'm struggling just reading it. And I want God to help me. Don't lie. Be honest and let Him correct you. I don't need you to raise your hand, but I will say, take a step out during this invitation time. Show the humility and come pray and ask God for strength to help you to get in His Word and to live by His Word. As the music starts,